Good evening again, everyone. Let's all take a deep breath. Wasn't that amazing? So we want to start the second half of our program tonight, first with a reminder that we are going to go straight into our wonderful dialogue with our amazing panel, and to make sure we announce that we are now live streaming this event. So everybody do a big shout out, Santa Monica College, yay. Welcome from Santa Monica College to those of you who are joining us virtually, and that we can do questions through Twitter at hashtag SMC Health Advocacy. So I have the privilege of giving you a little bit of a biographical introduction to the members of our panel. And they will then come out and join us on these sofas and start their panel discussion. Wash Westmoreland and his partner Richard Glatzer directed Still Alice, which of course won Julianne Moore an Oscar this year and has become Sony Pictures Classics' most awarded and most successful film of 2014. Still Alice has opened in over 60 countries worldwide and grossed over $52 million in its theatrical run. We are so honored to have Wash with us on the panel tonight. Barbra McLendon is the public policy director for the California Southland chapter of the Alzheimer's Association. For the past 10 years, she has focused on aging, long-term care policy, and advocacy that has resulted in landmark Alzheimer's legislation throughout California. Barbra? Freddie Siegel-Gadan is an assistant clinical professor at USC in neurology, family medicine, and gerontology, and is the director of the Rancho USC California Alzheimer's Disease Center. Among many other accomplishments, her work has helped shape the guidelines found in California Senate Bill 613 that we will be discussing tonight. Which brings us to Senator Ben Allen. Freddie? Oh, on this couch. Santa Monica's own Senator Ben Allen was voted into office in 2014 as the California State Senator representing District 26, which includes Santa Monica. Among many other legislative activities, Ben is a co-sponsor of Senate Bill 613, the Alzheimer's and Dementia Care Act, which he will be speaking about tonight. Ben lost his grandfather to Alzheimer's disease. Ben? And that brings me to our beloved friend and moderator tonight, Elizabeth Gelfand Stearns. Elizabeth is co-producer of the film Still Alice and also chairs the Judy Fund, which has raised over $5.4 million for Alzheimer's disease research and public policy efforts in partnership with the Alzheimer's Association. Elizabeth lost her mother and her grandmother to Alzheimer's disease. Please welcome our moderator, Elizabeth Gelfand Stearns.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. So happy to be here. Thank you all for joining us, and thank you for this terrific panel. I'm going to start by asking you all a question. How many here have been touched by Alzheimer's disease, personally? Thank you. We've been asking questions like that for I've been involved in this work for a decade, and what's amazing to me is seeing how much younger the response gets chronologically. So people now in their 20s, not just in their 50s and 60s and 70s and 80s. And we're going to start to talk about that and what Alzheimer's looks like, not only in California, but in this country and around the world, and why Alzheimer's and why a film like Still Alice really can help change the future of this disease. So to start, I would say the three takeaways that we hope that you'll get from the end of this panel is you're going to learn about the film, and we're so honored to have Wash Westmoreland here to talk to us about the process and why Still Alice, why this choice. We hope you're going to learn about Alzheimer's disease, and we have as great a panel as you're going to find in terms of the expertise on the disease itself and on legislation and what we're trying to do here in California. And then you're going to understand about public policy and what legislation is. And I'm so, so proud, again, to have our senator, our own Senator Ben Allen, here to talk about the great work that he is doing up in Sacramento that affects all of us in this state and ultimately in this country around the disease. So with that, I think what we're going to do is we're going to just start by talking about Alzheimer's today. You've just seen an incredible movie, but before we get into talking about the film, what we wanted to do was just bring everybody in this room very up to speed about the realities of Alzheimer's today. So we're going to start by cueing the first video, which is really just takes a look at Alzheimer's disease, what it looks like in America, what the facts are, what the figures are. So we can run with the first video.
One disease, millions of lives permanently disrupted. Today, there are over 5 million Americans living with Alzheimer's disease. But Alzheimer's is taking more than memories. It's taking lives. What few realize is that Alzheimer's kills more people than breast cancer and prostate cancer combined. And Alzheimer's is the only disease in the top 10 causes of death that can't be slowed, stopped, or prevented. From 2000 to 2013, while deaths from other diseases decreased significantly, Alzheimer's deaths increased 71%. But equally disturbing, many living with Alzheimer's say they are not being told their diagnosis. While more than 90% of people with the most common types of cancer say they are told their diagnosis, only 45% of people with Alzheimer's or their caregivers say they are told. The economic toll is staggering too. In 2015, it will cost the nation $226 billion to care for people with Alzheimer's. By 2030, 72 million baby boomers will reach an age of greater risk. The fact is, everyone's at risk for Alzheimer's, even you. But everyone can help, especially you. We're the Alzheimer's Association, the brains behind saving yours. Join us.
So that's the reality of this disease in this country. And now what I want to do is ask Barbara to talk about the reality of this disease right here in California.
Great, thanks, Elizabeth. So if we can put the slide up with the California statistics. Okay. So here in California, we do have a large population, which means we have a large population of people who are aging. So the numbers in California really are very striking. Here it is the fifth leading cause of death, which nationally it's the sixth leading cause of death. And that represents 169% increase in Alzheimer's deaths since 2000. Numbers of people 65 plus with Alzheimer's, you can see the growth that we expect. We're just a little under 600,000 right now in the state, and projected to rise to 840,000 in 2025, which to me feels like tomorrow, really. And then something that we really don't talk about a lot, and that's the caregivers. They are the backbone of the system that helps people who have dementia and Alzheimer's disease. And it's the informal caregivers that at the Alzheimer's Association we try to do a lot to help. And the numbers, again, in California are really sort of staggering. Hours of unpaid care, $1.7 billion, and the value of that care, over $21 billion. I mean, it's really a situation where if we aren't supporting those informal caregivers and they are no longer able to provide that care, they need to return to work, whatever their situation might be, our formal systems of care couldn't do what they do. So it is really essential that we recognize that those caregivers are there, that we understand their needs, and then we do something about meeting those needs.
Thank you. So just before we transition, I just want to leave you once again with that key to the whole thing. We're spending our federal government today, which means all of our taxpayer money from all over this country, is spending $230
billion dollars every single year taking care of people with Alzheimer's disease, but we're only spending $590 million researching for a cure. And if we go that way, that underwater way, we are going to take down every healthcare system in this country over the next 30 years just because of the aging population. 60 million people entering their Alzheimer's years are baby boomers. So all of this has great effect on all of us as taxpayers and as potential family members or individuals that will have to live with Alzheimer's disease. So from that, what I want to do is transition now into Still Alice, into the film Still Alice. I can't tell you how pleased I am and honored I am to have my very dear friend and a very wonderfully talented man. This is the man who really brought, along with his partner Richard, Still Alice to the screen. And I'd love to just start, Wash, by asking you to tell us your story. How did it begin? How did Still Alice begin?
For me, Still Alice began with a phone call out of the blue. And it was 2011, around November. And two British producers phoned us up and said, would you be interested in taking a look at this novel for adaptation? And they told us about Still Alice, and they told us what the story was about. And we did a little internet research, and the book that it's based on has, really been an important touchstone in the Alzheimer's community. It's brought so much awareness of the disease, and it tells such a powerful story. So we were aware that there was a great responsibility in adapting the book. And we started reading it and became very involved with the characters and the story. But we didn't quite know whether we should take this on. Earlier in that year, my partner Richard had received a diagnosis for ALS, and he had started lisping in his tongue as the first symptom. So we'd spent a lot of the year dealing with doctors and hospitals and neurologists. We even had some similar tests to what Alice has in the movie very early on when they suspected Richard had a stroke. And we, already had one fatal disease without a cure in our lives. We're like, do we need to take on this as well? It seemed like a very heavy load. But when we finished reading the book, we were both convinced that there were so many parallels between Alice's experience and Richard's experience that it would give us an emotional access to the story in a way that we could adapt it and make it very personal. And so we wrote our first draft of the script, and we got it to Julianne Moore. And then
tell
it
us
all
about
went
that.
From there.
Tell us about why Julianne Moore, how that happened, and did you know at that moment what would end up being the road for this movie and Julianne to the Oscars?
Oh, well, we didn't quite know we were going to end up seeing Julianne getting an Oscar, but we did think of her as like, oh, she's one of the most incredible actresses in the world. And if you look at her filmography, she showed an incredible range. You knew she could portray someone who had an incredible scintillating intelligence, but you also see in some of her movies she can act wordlessly. She can just do a lot very simply that's very, very strong. And we had got to know her on a previous project that she hadn't ended up doing, and it had broken our hearts, but we had ended up with one very valuable thing, which was Julianne Moore's email. So we wrote to her and told her about Still Alice, and she was immediately very interested, and we sent her the script. And that was on the Friday. On the Monday morning, we were Skyping with her, and she said, I'm in, at the beginning of the call. Which is a unique occurrence. Often there's such a song and dance trying to get an actor to commit to a movie, especially one that's so difficult as this. But she understood there was something about the story and something about the role that she really strongly connected to and that she knew she could portray all the way. And she did go all the way with all her research for the role.
And tell us a bit about that month just over a year ago in New York, that timing, the filming, the process, the supporting cast that came along.
Well, Julianne Moore was filming, Hunger Games.
that other little movie that she made last year.
And Because they filmed Hunger Games Part 3 and 4 together, but there was kind of a little break in the middle where Julianne Moore didn't have any scenes for about 7 weeks. And we said, oh, well, we only need 4.5 weeks to make Still Alice, so we'll kind of drop it in the middle of the Hunger Games. And it's actually really difficult to do that because a lot of the bigger films won't actually give you permission to take an actor who might be needed if their film gets rearranged for any reason. But they were really, really considerate and believed in the project, and Julie wrote to them asking, you know, can I do this? And they came through and said yes. So we're like, okay, we have our time slot. And it also worked for Kristen, and it worked for Alec, and it worked for Kate. So we're like, this is a miracle. It was right at the end of the worst winter that New York's had for 20 years. And it was freezing, and all the time we were preparing the movie, the whole of Manhattan was iced over, and it snowed everywhere. It was really difficult. And when we were actually scouting the beach for, you know, the scene where she's walking along the beach, everyone's going, how are we going to shoot this? I was going, well, she's walking along by the sea and she'll be wearing a t-shirt. And we were looking at it and the beach was covered in snow. And we're like, when are we going to shoot this? And we said, oh, 3 weeks' time. I mean, literally, the snow melted. When we shot that, it was 2 degrees above freezing. Everyone else was in Arctic parkas. But being a great actor, and with Kristen too, when they're walking down the boardwalk, it was so cold. But they just kind of pulled it off. And we had a series of little miracles like that happening through the shoot that made us all feel very inspired about the project. And also, when Richard came to work on the film, his disease had progressed so that he'd lost a lot of motor function in his hands, and he could only type with one finger on an iPad. So when we were on the set, you know, he could only communicate like this, but he was on set every day making his contribution. You know, like we always co-direct 50-50, and he was always there. And everyone on the crew was inspired seeing someone with a major difficulty in their lives breaking through in order to make the movie. And it sort of gave everyone a deeper sense of purpose.
Absolutely. The final thing that I'll ask about the film, and then we'll transition into what the power of this film and what it's been able to do, is tell us about that moment of watching Julianne Moore at the Oscars and what that must have felt like for this process, for this project for you.
It was a completely wonderful moment. It was the pinnacle of a process that had started in Toronto Film Festival in September, when we took the film in and no one was talking about it. If you looked at the press, people were looking at other films. And we had a slot on a Monday afternoon, and we were a kind of under-the-radar type film. And the film showed, and it just connected to the audience. And it's the greatest feeling when you're a filmmaker and you feel people around you just tuning into the film you've made. And people just responded very warmly. Julianne got 3 standing ovations. And the next day, there was a piece in Hollywood Reporter saying, if someone picks this film up and puts it out this year, Julianne could be in the Oscar race. Mm-hmm. And it's hard to pick up a film in September and release it by December, but Sony Pictures Classics picked it up and just pushed it out because they saw that opportunity and they felt that it was Julie's year, and they turned out to be exactly right. So for a small film, this film was made on a working budget of around $4 million. It got so much attention because of the awards race. It's like entering into a giant reality TV show. Like, who's going to win? Who's going to win? And the amount of, you know, articles and coverage it generated was phenomenal, way, way, way beyond the advertising budget for the movie. It just ballooned and became massive and was talked about all over the world and anticipated all over the world because of the spotlight the Oscars shone on it. And, of course, we were nervous, and Julie had won a lot of awards, but, you know, you never know what's going to be in that envelope. And we were hoping to be there, but actually Richard had a hospitalization just before, so we watched in the hospital. Mm-hmm. And we were in the intensive care unit, but the nurses were really great and let us smuggle in loads of champagne and loads of food. And then when she won, we all shouted so loud, I saw these orderlies coming down the corridor, and I thought there was, like, a medical emergency. But it was just a truly wonderful night and a very special day. And Julie and Richard were very close, and she was just texting him pictures from the car, pictures from the red carpet, the whole thing. So it was just a truly special night.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing that. Okay, so now what we want to do is we want to talk about how a body of work like that, how something like that, as powerful as that, can be transitioned to engage the public in the fight and ultimately really change policy and help people. And so to do that transition, there's two things that I wanted to show you. What we did was we created what we call a pivot campaign. So if you'll run the first slide, this is the pivot campaign called The Women Behind Still Alice. This slide ran, this ad ran in magazines and Time, People, it was on the Today Show, it was in this latest issue of Time Magazine. So this was what we created was a campaign around, we know that if we engage women in healthcare fights, that's what changes the game. It's what changed breast cancer. It's what changed, that's Go Red for heart cancer. That's who are the decision makers in America today and around the world about their own healthcare needs as well as their families. We need to engage women in the fight. Plus, women are disproportionately impacted, and you're going to hear that from Barbra and Freddie in a bit also. And so we knew we need to engage women. So we created an entire campaign called Wipe Out Alzheimer's. And Wipe Out Alzheimer's Disease is about a campaign to engage 1 million women and raise $5 million to research women's brains, because as Freddie will tell you, shockingly, in history, when you research things like for hearts and blood and brains, it's all male models. So there's not a lot of money spent on actually isolating women and women's brains. And so that's what this effort is about. And if you want to run the video, the campaign...
I'm Maria Shriver. Every 67 seconds, another brain will develop Alzheimer's, a deadly disease for which there is no cure. And 2 out of every 3 of them will be our mothers, our grandmothers, our sisters, and our daughters. By 2050, Alzheimer's will claim the minds of 16 million Americans. We are facing a national epidemic that has put women's brains at risk, and I believe that it will be women's brains who will turn the tide. So starting today, I'm asking the agitators, the instigators, and the innovators out there to join us with Wipe Out Alzheimer's, a grassroots movement of women who I believe can save the precious minds of future generations. I believe we'll succeed because I can still remember a time when cancer was a dirty word and an HIV diagnosis was a death sentence. I've seen the difference that more research can make, more awareness can make, and more empowerment can make in the lives of millions. And I know that we can do that again. So women, we start now. I hope you'll join us.
So that's Wipe Out Alzheimer's. That's our pivot campaign. And now what I'd like to do is pivot to the discussion of what happened, a case study here in California that is happening right now. And we'll go through the case study, and then we'll open it up to Q&A and look forward to your questions and engaging you. So where we're going to begin, we're going to begin this case study by starting with Freddie. Freddie's going to talk about what was the need, where are we in California, and what do we need to do in California, and how does a process like this begin?
So I think we've already done some steps in California. I direct one of 10 state-funded Alzheimer's disease centers called California Alzheimer's Disease Centers that are located at medical schools around the state. And these were established in the legislature's wisdom in 1985, which seems a long time ago probably for many of you. It was sort of the beginning of my career, actually, in healthcare. And these centers were designed in 1985 when the legislature realized that we were going to have this aging population and we needed to build capacity in our healthcare system to train individuals to be able to better diagnose, better treat older people with these devastating diseases, of which Alzheimer's is the primary dementia, but there are other dementias similar to Alzheimer's disease that also affect people as they age. And the centers have set up models of care, trained physicians, nurses, PAs, therapists, a range of healthcare providers, and we continue to do that But the centers can't do it all. And along the way, the centers realized that we are just 10 small centers. We needed some help, and we needed to create a standard of care for other people providing care throughout the state. And so the state centers got together back in the 1990s and developed some guidelines, some said that this is the way you should do things. Because what we had experienced throughout the state, and we continue to experience, is that people come to our centers and say, my mother, my husband, my sister, my aunt, you know, is having problems, and we went to see the doctor, and he or she said, well, there's nothing we can do, it's just aging. You know, and my response to that is, well, if it was your mother, would you say that to them? You know, it's not just aging. As we get older, we're more vulnerable to all kinds of illnesses, more hypertension, more heart disease, more cancer. Breast cancer is much more common amongst older women than younger women, but we think of younger women with breast cancer. Yet it is older women who die from breast cancer, but we don't think of that. As we get older, our bodies become more vulnerable to all kinds of diseases. And people say, well, I never used to hear about Alzheimer's. Well, that's because there never used to be so many older people. And as we get older, our brains actually become more vulnerable to certain diseases, Parkinson's disease, for example, and Alzheimer's disease. And so we have this sort of nihilistic approach, even amongst well-educated physicians and nurses, that believe, well, if you're older, it's going to happen to you. And so part of it is trying to make people understand that it's not normal. It's not normal to not remember who your grandchild is. It's not normal to not remember where you put your purse. I saw somebody just yesterday in clinic whose granddaughter said, I knew something was wrong when my grandmother couldn't find her purse and I found it in the cereal box. Okay? It's not a place you put your purse. In the cereal box. That's abnormal behavior, okay? But we have this idea that as people get older, strange behaviors are more acceptable, okay? So it's hard to know what's normal and what's not sometimes. But you would expect that physicians and other medical providers would be able to identify what's normal and not. But even today in 2015, there are many people who come to our centers because they've gone to providers in the community and been told, well, nothing's wrong. It's just normal. So that's the first part of it. And the second part of it is trying to make people understand that there are standards of care. When you have a chest pain and you go to the emergency room, there's a certain protocol that's followed for heart disease. When you fall down and break a leg, there's a certain protocol that's followed. And there is a certain protocol that should be followed for caring for people with dementia, both in the medical part of it and beyond the diagnosis in the treatment and management part of it. And we have to disseminate that to other providers, and we have to change that all the time because our knowledge does increase. So when I started in this business 30 years ago and was sitting in your seats, and I heard a lecture about Alzheimer's disease, I was told that it was a pre-senile dementia. That means it begins before age 65, like Alice. Alice had pre-senile onset, early onset dementia. That's a fairly rare cause of Alzheimer's disease. It's about 5% of the cases of Alzheimer's disease. Most Alzheimer's disease is in people who are age 60 or 65 and older, okay? And I was told by the person who I saw, I was being taught by, that, you know, when I asked questions, I don't know why I did ask questions about this disease, don't worry, you're never going to see it. You're hardly going to see it. Don't worry about this, you know. And that's partly because the knowledge in the mid-1970s was not what it is in 2015. And now when I go back and see the medical director of my program, I sort of laugh and say, you were wrong. You were wrong. I spent my entire day seeing people with this disease and things like it, you know. And yes, most of the people I see are over age 70 and into their 80s and 90s. But I have seen pre-senile onset dementia. The youngest person I have seen was 39 years old, and her husband brought her to us because she couldn't remember how to change the diaper on her 2-year-old. Oh. And that is really heartfelt, you know. But, you know, it's just as sad when somebody brings their grandmother or grandfather or their husband or wife and says, she no longer recognizes me. doesn't know who I am.
Right.
So we need to provide ways for people to be supported in their care, and we need to find, as you said, the answers. I strongly believe that we will find the answer to these diseases. We understand the biology of Alzheimer's disease in ways today in 2015 we didn't understand in 2000. We have ways of making the diagnosis much better than we did in even 2010, okay? But we don't have good treatments. The treatments we have for Alzheimer's disease in 2015 are like the treatments we had for high blood pressure in 1970. Okay. In 1970, mid-1970s, there were five drugs for hypertension, high blood pressure. Of those five drugs, only two of them do we still use. Three of them have fallen out of favor because there's 25 other better drugs. We have five drugs for Alzheimer's disease today. Okay. None of them change the disease. They all manage the symptoms. But we have other drugs in the pipeline that we're developing as we understand the disease that I believe will change the disease. There was a recently, about 6 weeks ago, at a neurology meeting, for the very first time, reports of a research that showed that a drug that was given in a very small trial actually stopped the accumulation of the plaques in the brain.
And that's the Biogen.
Yes.
This is on the cover of Fortune magazine. That's what a big deal this is.
Right, right. So this is a very small trial. It is the first time in my lifetime of working in healthcare, and I've been in healthcare for 30 years, that we have had a report of a drug that actually changed the disease in Alzheimer's. Okay? It is, I think we're on the brink of this. But it takes money. As you said, it takes a lot of money, okay, to take a drug from the bench to the bedside, from the laboratory to the person, takes a lot of time and a lot of money. And there are a lot of barriers to doing this, particularly in these diseases, because these diseases take a long time to develop. It's not like you have a cold and you take an antibiotic and you're better in 3 days.
Right, right.
Or you have an aggressive cancer and you're trying to turn it off in a couple of weeks. These are diseases that change slowly over months, so that the drugs have to work slowly over time, and it takes a long time to get people into the trials. The other thing I would say is that we have a culture. How many of you would be willing to step up and use a drug that's in experimental trial? Yay for you. Boo for the rest of you. Because if you're not willing to step up and be part of the solution, then don't ask for the cure when you need it, or when your mother needs it, or your sister needs it. We need to have a culture where everybody's willing to be part of the solution, where everybody participates in research, so we get the answers quicker, where we don't exclude people. Elizabeth mentioned how women were excluded from research for years. Women, particularly of childbearing years, were excluded from research. So if you were between the ages of 18 and 50, you couldn't be part of any kind of research because of the concern about your child. But how do we know what a drug does in a 40-year-old woman then?
Exactly.
If we don't have women in the trials. So we all have to be willing to step up. And what we're trying to do is create a culture both of standards of care for people, where regardless of whether they come to a state center or they go to a community physician, and to encourage people to participate in research to help us find the answers. So I hope if you do have a chance to participate in research, you will say yes rather than no. Well, and if you have a parent, a loved one with a condition for which there's a chance to be part of the solution, you will encourage them to participate.
Thank you. I mean, part of it is being educated about what research is. So that's a perfect transition now for... Now, what Freddie talked about was understanding and identifying the need, writing the guidelines. But then, how do you make this happen? How do you create change? And Barbra is going to help take the next.
So here we are at the Alzheimer's Association, and we've got this disease that millions of Americans are dealing with, that hundreds of thousands of Californians are dealing with, that's costing the country billions of dollars, but nobody wants to talk about it. It's difficult to get attention to the issue. And so we thought about, you know, what was happening out there in the policy world
And Senator, I know this is very familiar to you. There's Senator Carol Liu, along with others over the last few years, had been putting out wonderful reports saying, you know, we need to do a better job of serving our aging community, a better job specifically of serving people with Alzheimer's disease, and here are some ideas. We could do this, we could do that. But to take those really good ideas and the need that we know is there for change, we need to do a better job, like I said, addressing needs of caregivers as well as people with the disease. And putting that together and making change happen, getting elected officials to say, yes, I'll do it. I'll carry that piece of legislation. I will make that change happen in our community. It's really tough. So we hit upon this idea. It felt actually like an incredibly rich environment for us at the association over the last 6 to 8 months, because we had this amazing film in Still Alice, and then we also had this amazing documentary that I think some of you may have seen last night, I'll Be Me, and the Campbell family, which had really been engaging with the association, wanting to get the word out. And we thought, let's do a movie screening in Sacramento. Because a movie screening in LA, that's not so uncommon. I mean, you guys probably all see an opportunity to go to a movie screening fairly regularly, and you think, well, not that one, I'll go to one maybe. But in Sacramento, this is not so common.
It's not that bad.
Okay, but it's a little bit like Hollywood's come to town, yeah?
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, it's a little. So we thought, okay, we're gonna show the I'll Be Me documentary, and maybe we'll get like 200 people to come to this lovely old theater in Sacramento. We had 700 to show up. It was extraordinary. And one of those people was Senator Allen. And so all of a sudden, what started to come together was, we know the need, we have some framework for change in reports that have been done, and now we've created awareness and interest in, hey, this is happening, and you know what? It's not okay. We need to do something. And in walked Senator Allen to say, the somebody who could do something, that could be me. And we started that conversation about this. I think with an understanding, and I've heard you say this, you know, that we're kind of in this for the long haul, right? Mm-hmm. We're not going to pass 10 bills this session that are going to fix everything, but we're going to start the process. Yeah. And so I think that with the legislation you're carrying, that's what we're doing. We're starting the process.
It's fantastic, fantastic. Yeah. So before we ask our senator to bring it home, this entire story, what I want to do is interject, I think here in the audience, Trevor Albert, who is the producer of I'll Be Me, is here. Where is Trevor? Trevor, stand up.
Yeah.
You're here. Okay. So Trevor has a lot to do. Trevor has a lot to do with everything that we're talking about up here, and I'll Be Me and Still Alice have really held hands and gone on a long marathon together, and we still have a long way to go, but it's a pleasure to have done it, really, with I'll Be Me. So thank you. And now, I'm so proud to hear and to ask our Senator Ben Allen to explain your story as to why, when this all came to you, how did this all happen?
Well, thank you, first of all, to you, Elizabeth, and to Richard DeVilderon and Sherry Davis and all the folks from the SMC PPI that have helped to put this together. It's a wonderful, wonderful tradition at the campus. Every single year, we look at a new public policy issue. And this year, of course, we're looking at a lot of issues relating to public health. And one of the neat traditions that we've started is film screenings. A couple years ago, we had a symposium on urban youth, and we had Boys in the Hood, and the director of that film came in and spoke to the students and was able to engage. It's such a special thing. You know, here we are in Los Angeles at the heart of the entertainment industry to have this access and this opportunity to interact with people from the film industry, which is such a powerful, powerful medium. Ultimately, we are all storytellers. And this is when we used to sit around the campfire as cavemen, we were all telling stories because we had nothing else to do. And in fact, people who study human psychology, we know that stories, human stories, individual stories are really what move people. And that's, of course, the power of a film. In fact, fundraisers will talk about how you can send out a letter filled with statistics and it will only move people so much. But if you focus on one person's story, that will get people excited. That will get people moving. So we obviously have two extraordinary Alzheimer's films that have come out this year, both of which they made it to the Oscars. One of them was nominated for Best Documentary. And then, of course, this extraordinary performance by Julianne Moore. Now, of course, my personal story is a part of what brings me to this experience, and that is that I am the grandson of a victim of Alzheimer's. My grandfather, who everybody in my family talks about with such love and reverence and enthusiasm and excitement, my older brother, my mother, her sister, my grandmother, this was a man who just lit up a room, who was so full of love, so full of warmth, so funny. He would sing. He was a comedian. He also was a pediatrician. He took care of generations of young people in Hartford, Connecticut. And just every single person I've ever talked to who ever came across this man, Manny Hirschberg is his name, just speaks with such love and adoration and for this man. And of course, my only memory of him was on his deathbed. I mean, I went there as a little boy, and got to see him deep in the throes of dementia and of Alzheimer's. And I always felt a little sad about that, because I didn't have the experience of getting to know him and getting to know what a special person he was. Of course, I've benefited very much from his love and his personality, because it shone through my mother and my brother and others who got to know him so well. But it's always been something that I felt a little sad about, not getting to know him. And of course, it got me aware of Alzheimer's. And my mother, of course, has been thinking a lot about Alzheimer's. She's been desperately doing crossword puzzles to stave off the possible, she's wonderful. She's actually here in the audience tonight, my mom, Lynn Allen. And I'm proud to say that her memory is just as good today as it was 20 years ago. Of course, just as good as mine. We always lose things everywhere, but it's not because of, fortunately not because of anything that we've been looking at in the film today. So it's a personal story for me. It's an experience that I lived through. I got a chance to read a lot about Alzheimer's as a kid. We got the Alzheimer's Association newsletters and all that sort of thing, and so I learned about the disease. And so when we were pulling together a package of bills relating to aging care, I heard about this effort to try to put some legislation forward that would codify, that would push the Department of Health, Public Health, to start to re-examine the guidelines that oversee the way that we treat people with Alzheimer's around the state, I wanted to be a part of that effort. In the legislature, we only have a certain number of bill slots. So we've got to be very careful, and we're constantly being asked by so many different people to carry bills for them. We also, of course, have our own ideas, and there's issues from the district. But this was something that was very personal to me, and something that was special to me. And so I was just very, very, very happy to be part of this effort. I mean, ultimately, there's so many challenges out there, so many social policy challenges out there. But it really does take people to step up and engage and put a little bit of emphasis, a little bit of energy into the effort. It's interesting when we talk about the cost. The striking statistic that Elizabeth raised earlier was that we're spending $230 billion a year on Alzheimer's care, and yet we're only spending $500 million on trying to come up with a cure, with really trying to understand and study this disease scientifically. And one of the things that we've learned over and over again, whether it was the AIDS epidemic, cancer, some of the great challenges behind polio and smallpox, it really takes energy and emphasis and money and resources and scientific focus to really come up with solutions. The wonderful thing is that our scientists and our doctors and our population are so strong that when we do work together, and when we do put our money where our mouths are, and we do put emphasis and energy into research, they come up with extraordinary things. And if you look at the medical advances that we've had in the last 100 years, it is extraordinary, and it's changed human life as we know it. And I'm just so hopeful that real investment will get us there with Alzheimer's as well. So this SB 613 that we have this year is part of that effort. We got past the health committee just recently, and a number of people from the Alzheimer's Association came up to speak on its behalf. Now we go to the appropriations committee. Then it will go, hopefully, if everything works well there, to the Senate floor. It's a long process. It's just like Schoolhouse Rock, you know, how a bill becomes a law. I'm living that song now. And some of it's fun, some of it's not. But it's an exciting thing to be able to be in a place where I can make a difference on an issue that's so close to my family and to my own experience and just the experience of so many others. And I just am very grateful both to the extraordinary work of the Alzheimer's Association and also the artists who put this film together and I think brought this issue with such poignancy and grace to so many people. And I'm really hopeful that this film and the Glenn Campbell film and other works of art will inspire people to start to take this issue seriously and bring us to the promised land of a cure for this debilitating, devastating disease. So, thank you.
Beautiful. Perfect. Perfect. So now, to bring it all full circle, and then we want to open it up for Q&A, so start thinking about your questions. I think that, you know, what Ben just said, what the senator just said, which is so interesting to think about, is that historically, we know that art can influence change. And if you look at films like Philadelphia, when the film Philadelphia came out in the 1980s, I think about 1982, 83, you know, what people prior to that thought about AIDS, about HIV, and then all of a sudden, Tom Hanks is an attorney playing this character that opened up the world and opened up your hearts and brought empathy around a disease that most people were very afraid of. Yes. They didn't want to talk about, they were afraid to shake hands with strangers that they might get the scary disease. It was so misunderstood. And it took something like Philadelphia or a more recent movie. It was actually a film that when I was at Universal, I worked on A Beautiful Mind and what that did for schizophrenia. So we know that art can do that. And so that's why continuing for the film majors that are here, I know there was a bunch of them last night watching All Be Me, art can do this. Music can do this. Many things can do this. And we hope to encourage the young people that are here to continue to think about things like that, that that really can propel change. So with that, I want to open it up to question and answer. And I think what we do is we have microphones on either side. And Lizzie is reminding me to say that the first 12 questions we have the DVD of Still Alice to give to you. You'll be walking away for the first 12 people, so we want to incentivize people to come up to the microphone and ask questions. You've got an excellent panel here. No question is irrelevant or wrong. So why don't we start? I think I see somebody right here. We'll start to our left.
Good evening, and thank you again for coming and discussing these issues for us. Tonight wouldn't have been possible without you. And first of all, I have a couple questions going back to the scientific aspect of Alzheimer's. I had an aunt who I lost to Alzheimer's, but I was pretty young, so I didn't know too much of the effects and ins and outs. But do we know what causes Alzheimer's? And also, I noticed in the movie, the doctor said that higher educated people, if you will, seem to progress faster. So do we know
Freddie?
The reasons for those?
So I don't know about higher educated people progressing faster, but higher educated people are less likely to develop Alzheimer's disease. So I often say that Head Start is the best Alzheimer's disease prevention program we have. Because it is early childhood education where we make the connections between our nerve cells called synapses that then when we go through adolescence get actually pruned back And they literally get pruned back. So if you have more connections and then pruning, you still have more to left, you're left with. So we do know that higher education is a protective factor for Alzheimer's disease and other dementias. Now, that doesn't mean that because I have a PhD, I'm never going to get Alzheimer's disease, but I'm just less likely to have it.
I think in the film makes the point that sometimes people who are more educated are able to mask.
They're able to mask it. Yes. So we call that cognitive reserve, that you have more, like in your reserve tank. You have a bigger reserve tank, like in your gas tank. So if you only have a half a gallon in your gas tank of reserve and it hits the light, you can't go very far. But if you have 5 gallons in there, you can still go far when you have a gas tank on. So people build up their cognitive reserve when they are more highly educated. So oftentimes they don't appear, you don't see the symptoms as early. And once you see the symptoms, there's been more brain degeneration going on. So the decline may be initially greater. That may be. Now, to answer your question about the underlying biology, we know a lot about it. So the first description of Alzheimer's was in 1906 by somebody by the name of Dr. Alzheimer. That's how it got its name. And he was an Austro-Hungarian physician who actually worked in an asylum. And he was a gentleman brought his wife, his Fraulein, to him because she wasn't doing her wifely duties. You can think what that might be. It wasn't because she had memory problems, and she was accusing him of affairs and other sundry things. And he examined her. She actually said something very profound. She told him, "I have lost myself." And I think that really summarizes Alzheimer's. I have lost myself. And he described when she died a few years later, in her brain what are called tangles and plaques, which are the evidence of degeneration in the brains under the microscope. And we now know what the biology is of the tangles and plaques that has been unraveled through our research just in the last 20 years. The plaques are called by an abnormal protein called an amyloid that builds up, and the tangles are caused by an abnormal protein, tau. So these diseases, similar to Parkinson's disease, and possibly to ALS even, are all related to the accumulation of proteins that become misfigured and actually become toxic to the brain in different places in different ways. So we understand the biology much better than we used to.
Thank you. Okay, should we go back and forth on one side to the next?
So first and foremost, I want to thank you all for being here. Without your support, the Public Policy Institute of SMC, we wouldn't have this. So I want to thank you guys first and foremost. So pretty much my question really is, how do we get this disease to be, how do we kind of de-villainize it? I guess is, what I'm asking is, one of my best friends, his grandmother had Alzheimer's, and now, she pretty much went through a stroke, and now she's on life support. So pretty much, how do we make it something that cannot be trying to think how to say this, like...
Stigmatized.
Thank you.
Barbra?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much for that question, because that really goes to the heart, I think, of one of the major challenges we have in getting people to engage on this issue and push for change, is because it's still very much the case that many individuals don't want to talk about it. I work with a lot of advocates, and there are always a couple of people who come to me and they're not ready yet to be public. So they're engaged with the association, they're part of a support group, they want to do advocacy, they know they want to do something so that other people aren't having to deal with what they're having to deal with. But it's a process for them to go from having that diagnosis and being willing to be public about it. So I think one of the ways that we get at that stigma is through movies, just like these two. Because just as Elizabeth's example with Philadelphia, that's Tom Hanks up there, and he has AIDS. Now it's, that's Julianne Moore up there and she has Alzheimer's? That's not what I pictured in my head of what someone with Alzheimer's looks like. And so the association works hard to try and get people to understand Alzheimer's disease looks a lot of different ways. As many different people as there are in the world, that's what it looks like. It's all of us. And so I think the more we can put out there into the media, in front of as many eyeballs as possible, that message, we destigmatize the disease and bring people out from, you know, their own individual islands of fear and shame and misery into community. And when we join together, we make change happen.
Absolutely. Beautifully said. Thank you. Okay, we're going to go on this side.
Hi. My question is mostly directed towards Dr. Freddy, but any of you are welcome to answer it. Obviously, a big part of the film was her making a video to assist herself when she gets to a certain part with suicide. So I was wondering whether or not you think it's morally correct to have a physician assist suicide and whether or not it should be legal.
Wow.
And also whether or not you think that once a person gets to a certain age or a certain point in their disease, if it's okay for someone to assist themselves in suicide, like what is just your moral perspective on it?
Freddie.
Well, so I am a big proponent of choice for people throughout their lives. I think that we are fortunate to live in a country where we have lots of choices, too many choices sometimes. And I think choice is important up to the time of death even. And the young woman who recently moved from California to Oregon in order to be able to end her life with dignity, I think is a real hero. And I say that because not only did she do something I think very courageous in being in control of her own life, she had a deadly brain tumor, but she changed the face of the people who do that, because our face are the people who are, we think of assisted suicide and dying, are older people with strokes or Alzheimer's or dementia, and here was this young woman who took that courageous stand. I think it's not my position as a healthcare provider to tell somebody else how to live their life or how to end their life. I believe we all should have the choice to do that. The caveat being that we should make sure that somebody understands what their choices are fully. And if somebody is in pain, we need to give them choices to get out of pain and not think that their only choice is to end their life, to be out of pain. And I don't mean just physical pain, I mean psychological pain as well. Part of that is our access to mental health care in this country, which is not equal to what our access is to physical health care. And we have a huge crisis in the need for mental health care for people to help them understand their ways to get out of pain that may even be physical, that has a psychological component.
And with reference to the movie, I think it really comes into focus in the scene where Alice discovers the video message that she made for herself previously in the year before, and, you know, receives the instructions for her own suicide. I think what you're looking at here is two Alices. There's the original Alice who thought, I don't want to live when I'm in that condition. But then you've also got the present day Alice who has said, I still experience joy in life, who has still, you know, moments of love and moments of connection in her world, who doesn't want to end her life. So even though it's Alice's will, it's Alice in the past who has laid down that condition, and Alice in the present day who no longer, given the choice, would want to take her life. So I think that's why it's a very complicated and interesting sequence to see whether, you know, I think half the audience are saying, don't do it, and half the audience are saying, do it. You know, I mean, depending on what your own projected desire would be for yourself in that situation.
I'd love to also ask the senator, in terms of legislation around this, that's become a big conversation and topic. Should that be legislated? Is that something that we there should be told there should be a framework for?
Well, so much of medical care is regulated, and certainly things involving death and are justifiably regulated. There are two of my colleagues in the state Senate, Senator Lois Wolk and Bill Monning, have just put forward legislation to allow for death with dignity, and it basically would very closely model the Oregon, mirror the Oregon model, that would allow people to go ahead and, you know, with all of these caveats, making sure that there's not undue coercion, that there's, you know, very much a free decision being made, that there's not a mental health issue, that people would be empowered to make that own decision for themselves. The extraordinary thing about Oregon, by the way, is that once people have obtained the tools to end their own life, only about 50% of them actually end up using it. But the mental health actually increases significantly. They study this. It's very interesting for those who for those who end up deciding not to, because they suddenly have the power in their own hands to make their own decision. And one of the extraordinary things, I think, you know, we have this image of people who are in this sort of condition as being very much victims. Right. And I think the example of this young woman from Oregon is that she was not a victim. She took power over her own situation and was able to make her own decisions. And it really was an empowering act, as difficult as that is. Now, of course, we're being flooded with lots and lots of perspectives. And, you know, I'm supportive of the bill. I know that some of my colleagues are struggling with it a bit because they're very, very worried about some of the implications. You know, are people going to be pushed into this? Are people going to end their own life because they don't want to be a burden on their family? You know, we saw this a little bit here. Are people going to, you know, are people going to feel as though the pain's too bad, and so they don't want to end their life, even if they may have options, palliative options? So folks in the medical community have been very concerned about this. There are deep conversations going on with the doctors, the California Medical Association. You know, it's a difficult conversation, but I do agree, you know, with the perspective that was just shared here, that ultimately my balancing goes toward the empowerment and giving people the choice. But it's not without very difficult moral implications. And I know a lot of the members of the legislature are really struggling with this right now. When you ask whether it's appropriate for us to make a decision, it's got to be made somewhere. You know, and ultimately, we have, you know, it's the state government's responsibility to regulate, you know, the healthcare system.
Yes.
And so, you know, this is in our bailiwick. This is in our set of responsibilities. But ultimately, it's a societal decision. And if you feel strongly about this one way or another, I really do ask you to call into your representatives and write letters to the editor and engage in this process. It's been a long and difficult process in the legislature, but it's very much going to be the product of millions and millions of perspectives that will eventually emerge from the legislative process.
Thank you. Okay, I'm going to go over here.
Hi, thank you all for doing those great works, and I have a lot of questions. That I noticed this disease cannot be prevented or cured. Is medical help advancing able to slow down this process of this disease? And when it seems likely to pass to our next generation, do we have a solution for people who confirm having this disease and they want to have babies? And where should people go? What should people do when they have relatives and who have this disease? Right. And how can we help them?
Great, excellent question. Thank you. So, Freddie, before I just want to kind of frame and interject one scene from the film that I think is something that we, from the association standpoint, and certainly from a filmmaking standpoint, the idea in the movie that generationally, this disease was stopped because, of course, Alice's daughter, who was going through IVF to try and get pregnant, they were able to adjust and conceptualize and stop a disease that was a familial disease. So I'd love you to address sort of both ends of that in terms of the question and then the familial part of it.
So let me talk about the genetics of the disease a little bit. So we understand that in the form that Alice is portrayed as having is an unusual form. Not only is it early onset, but it's called a familial Alzheimer's disease, FAD, we call it, for which we have identified three genetic mutations. So all of we are all a product of our biology as well as our environment. And our biology comes from our parents, and then it's interacted upon by our environment. Some things are more genetically driven than other things, but everything has some genetic component to it. So your height and your skin color and all your other attributes come from your parents, you know, and we look at pictures and oh, you look like Aunt so-and-so, and you know, your smile is like so-and-so. And Alzheimer's disease, just like hypertension and diabetes and cancers, all have a genetic component. Some cancers, for instance, we know about breast cancer, some have a strong genetic component and some don't. And some forms of Alzheimer's disease, a very rare forms, have a strong genetic component. And most of Alzheimer's disease doesn't have as strong a genetic component. We have one gene for late onset Alzheimer's that is a risk factor, but not a determinant of getting it. The genetics of Alzheimer's are not completely understood. Only in a small amount are they understood. I do not know of anybody presently, but I'm not in OBGYN, doing in vitro fertilization who is going in and selecting for or against any of the known Alzheimer's genes. I have not heard of that being done, that kind of genetic manipulation. I know there is some in vitro selections done for some very strongly inherited conditions, but those are very rare. And there's a lot of ethical, if you think there's ethical issues around end of life, there's ethical issues on the beginning of life and the genetic piece. But so in that part of the film, I don't know how accurate that is today. I've not heard of anybody doing that. But I do know, for instance, Huntington's disease, a very rare genetic disease that is strongly inherited. There are people who choose not to have children because they're carrying the disease. But I don't know if they chose to have children in vitro, whether they would go in and select for it. I don't know that. Now, there was another part of her question.
I think it was, what do you do if you are someone who has...
One of the questions was about stopping the disease. The drugs we have do not change the disease. They don't stop the disease. They don't slow down the disease process. They do slow down some of the cognitive and behavioral changes for a little bit. They boost some of the neurochemicals in the brain so that you have more of these substrates around for the neurons to use. But they don't really, they buy about 6 to 18 months of slowing down the decline. They don't really do much more than that.
But were you also asking about risk reduction? Is there anything you can do? Because at the Alzheimer's Association, we don't talk about preventing it, because we can't. But we do talk about reducing your risk. And that's when we use phrases like, what's good for your heart is good for your head. Mm-hmm. So eating well, you know, the Mediterranean diet, exercise, everybody in this room needs to be regularly exercising. That's good for you for many reasons, and one of them is it's going to be something that can reduce your risk for developing Alzheimer's or another dementia. So I think there are things that people can do, and that's one of the messages that we want to get out. You heard in the very beginning the statistic about how less than half the people who have a dementia diagnosis are told of it. And you ask yourself, why? Why would a doctor not tell someone that they have Alzheimer's or dementia? I think there's a lot of things going on there, and I'm sure, Freddie, you could speak to this. But I think part of it is, unfortunately, this feeling, even among some healthcare professionals, that it's just hopeless. There's just nothing that we can do about it. We want to push back against that and say that it's not hopeless. There are things you can do to reduce risk. There are things that you can do to help your family members who have the disease have better outcomes, better care that can be provided. There is a lot that can be done. So it really is worth educating yourself about this disease and then taking action.
Absolutely.
We have time for one question more.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Wait, who gets the rest of the films?
We'll leave that up to Richard and Sherry.
Right. Right. We'll get to toss them.
Right. Okay, so my question is, I'm wondering the caretakers and how obviously the labor they put into it, along with the amount of time they put into taking care, obviously, for people with Alzheimer's. But I want to understand the toll emotionally that they take on, and if so, is there any counseling that could help and ways to advocate and give awareness to others, but also support the people that are hurt the most, which are family members, friends, et cetera. Mm-hmm. And then the second,
I would say this quite frankly, the victims of Alzheimer's disease are not the people with the disease. They are the family members of the people with the disease. Most people with Alzheimer's disease are very happy. Unlike Julianne Moore's character, many don't have much awareness of the changes that they're only experiencing, but the people around them are very aware of the person's changes. And so it is actually the families and the caregivers who we can really help the most. And there are lots of services. The Alzheimer's Association and other organizations provide caregiver support, caregiver education. Mm-hmm. One of the best ways to care for somebody with Alzheimer's is to get educated, for the education for the caregiver and the family, so that they can respond in ways that help to promote independence and function, and also take care of themselves. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like when you get on the airplane and you have to take the mask for yourself before you have the one next to you. If caregivers don't take care of themselves, then they aren't around to take care of the person who has Alzheimer's disease. And the most tragic cases are when that I've seen in the years that I've done this are where caregivers sort of give up their lives for the person with Alzheimer's, and then the caregiver gets ill. Mm-hmm. And then everything falls apart. Right. And the caregiver Absolutely. Is in the hospital, and the Alzheimer's spouse has now got to be moved someplace, mm-hmm. and it's just a mess. Right. So caregivers right. really need to take care of themselves. And one of the difficulties we have is that we don't pay people to be caregivers. They're called mothers, sisters, daughters, aunts, unpaid work.
Yeah. One thing we wanted to do with the end of the movie was to show with Kristen Stewart's character the value of caregiving as a life choice. Like, other family members were running away from it, trying to rearrange their lives so they didn't have to deal with Alice. And she took this really brave decision to come back and look after her mother. And we just wanted the movie to say, it's a valuable thing to do, and it's a wonderful thing to do, and it's a tremendously difficult thing to do. Mm-hmm. But, hopefully, I was very much like a caregiver for Richard for the last years of his life. It's so hard, and you need support, and you need to take care of yourself. But then there's these moments of connection and moments of closeness that are so precious that, that's what being alive is about. Mm.
Beautiful.